Good morning and welcome to New Providence Baptist Church. As we begin our service today, I invite you, if you will, to stand and sing with us. If you're joining us online this morning, sing with us too. It's going to be a good day.
Yours will be the only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I see, the only one that matters to me. Yours will be the friendship and affection I need to feel my Father smiling on me.
This afternoon at 4:30, church council and the deacons will be meeting in the youth house with a fellow from Tennessee Baptist Convention. Then at 6 o'clock, the ladies' Bible study, they'll be meeting down there as well. And then at 6:30, if you want to help us out pack the boxes for the boxes of blessings for Venezuela, we'll be doing that in here at 6:30. And we'll have to sort it all out and pack it. So if you want to come and help, you come on. If you don't want to come and help, you come anyway, all right? So be here at 6:30 to do that. And then just want to let you know one announcement coming up in 2 weeks on a Sunday night, be the 24th. We're going to have the Philadelphia Elementary School Choir will be presenting their music. They do it every year for us, and they'll be here that night. So that's coming up in 2 weeks. And if you come, we're going to go down to the fellowship hall afterwards and have homemade ice cream sundaes. So we'll entice you any way we can to get you here, all right? Brother Tony, didn't know this, but Brother Tony's class is going to be serving them for us, all right? So y'all be dishing out the ice cream. And I never forget, it was about 2 years ago, maybe three, that we were doing this. And Jay Witcher, is Jay Witcher here today? I'll talk about him then. Jay Witcher was his responsibility that night was the whipped cream for the ice cream sundae. And this girl came up and she wanted a bowl and she said, "Oh, there's no more bowls." And I said, "I'm sorry." I said, "What did you want? I'll make it work some way for you." She said, "Well, really all I wanted was some whipped cream." And Jay said, "Well, that's not a problem. Just come over here and open your mouth." And she did, and he did. He said, "Is that okay for me to do that, preacher?" And I said, "Well, it's too late now." And I mean, he filled it up and it was coming out. I thought she was going to choke, but she did well. She survived and all. So that'll be up, coming up in 2 weeks. And then remember, Charles will be preaching this morning and also then next Sunday. I'm going on vacation tomorrow and leaving town and taking my phone off the hook. Actually going to a cabin my sister owns up somewhere in the mountains of North Carolina. They don't even have phone signal. So if you try to get me and I'm not responding, it's not because I don't like you. It's because I didn't want to talk to you. No, I'm just kidding. It's because I can't. All right? So I'll be there. I'll be gone. And then I can't remember who's doing Wednesday night this week. Do you remember? Somebody is doing Wednesday night Bible study. Anybody want to volunteer? No, I'm just kidding. We got it scheduled. All right? God bless you. I hope you have a great week. Help us out with the boxes of blessings tonight. Be praying for us this afternoon as we meet with Brother Steve Hope from the Tennessee Baptist Convention. He's going to be helping us into what we should be doing in the next coming days and the days ahead, all right? So we're trying to do what God would have us to do, not what we want to do. Let's pray. Father, we come to you, ask you to cleanse and forgive us. Thank you for all you do and all the things that you are doing. Lord, I pray that we would open our eyes and open our ears, that we'd hear you and we'd see you above everything else. Lord, there's a lot of distractions and there are a lot of things that can take our mind away and our thoughts away and our actions. But Lord, help us to be tuned into you. And may we all bring glory and honor to your name. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. God bless you.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like fire.
We invite you to stand and sing with us today.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety. I speak Jesus. streets. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus.
Sing with us today.
Shout Jesus from the mountain.
To heal, to restore, to mend the hurt, to free the captive. There is so much available to you today. We invite you to speak Jesus today.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the street, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name.
Sing with us today.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
sing that with us again this morning.
Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like a fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms, they all pass away, but there's something
Heavenly Father, we thank you for Jesus, because without him, Lord, we wouldn't be able to even come into your presence, Lord. Lord, we come to you this morning, Lord, to ask you to cleanse and forgive us, Lord, to open our hearts and our minds, Lord, that we might receive a word from you this morning. Lord, I ask you to be with Charles as I prayed for him this week. Lord, I pray that you will find him obedient this morning, Lord, to preach the word that you have laid on his heart, the way that you have laid it on his heart, Lord, and I ask you to let my ears hear what you have to say, Lord. Lord, thank you for all that you do for us, Lord. I do ask you, Lord, to be with our families of the church that will be traveling this week during fall break. Lord, I ask you to give some rest to those that need it and a good time for those that can, Lord. Lord, we thank you for all that you do for us. It's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Bless your name.
this morning? There we go. I can hear me. So it's a pleasure and a privilege to be up here and get the chance to preach to you this morning. I hate the reason I'm having to do it, but I'm going to do it obediently and faithfully as I possibly can. So let's pray before we get started. God, I love you. God, I thank you for this day. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to just have a chance to preach the word of God in this pulpit. Father, I pray that you would just remove me out of the way. I pray, God, that you would fill me with the Holy Spirit, God, that you would speak through me. God, that it wouldn't be my opinions, my thoughts, my desires, God, but it would be yours. Father, I love you and I thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, we're going to be in Genesis today, looking at Genesis 1 through 3. I'm going to spend most of our time in Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 19. Of the three, that's the least happiest of the chapters, but that's kind of where we're going to be. It's going to be a bad news kind of day a little bit. Next week, we're going to get into some good news, but today's going to be mostly bad news. This is not what I had planned to preach as of yesterday. I had something else, been looking at two or three different things. And as I sat down last night, the Lord kind of changed my heart. And this is the direction we are going to go. So over this week and the next, I want us to kind of get a chance to kind of reorient kind of around the idea of what the gospel is. And we use that word a lot, the gospel, right? We talk about spreading the gospel, preaching the gospel, getting the gospel out to the world. But sometimes we don't really know or even understand what the gospel is. So as we kind of define that word, the gospel, of course, if you've studied that word, it means good news, right? But there's something to consider when we talk about good news, right? In order for there to be good news, it kind of has to invade, has to go into bad spaces sometimes in order for there to be good news, right? For good news to occur, it has to invade places where some anxiety or some fear may happen or may occur, right? When you get the news from your doctor that you're healthy, that things are good, you know, that's woo, right? That's good news, right? If you ask someone to marry you and they say yes, that's good news. We hope that is good news, right? It's good news because there's a chance that something bad could happen. Things could go nasty in a couple of those different situations, right? It's in order for us to fully understand that there is good news, we first have to understand that there is some bad news, right? So, like I said, just an FYI, just to kind of adjust your expectations, it's a little bit of a bad news day, but thank God. We've already kind of given you the answer to the test, right? We sang about it for the last 15, 20 minutes about what the good news is, but first we're going to get into a little bit of what the bad news is, because I think that once we really understand the position that we're in, it makes the good news all that more glorious, all that more wonderful what it is that God has done for us. Because if you didn't know, if you haven't looked at your phone or listened to the news or read the news or however you do it, this world is a pretty busted up place. This world is we're not doing good, right? We're not doing real good. And some people are really kind of tuned into this. Some people get that more than others. I think about our police officers, our social workers, cancer doctors, right? People who see evil and death in the world every day. And for most of us, we're not really dialed in like that. We're not seeing this stuff every day, right? We don't really get the brokenness of the world in a day-to-day place. But every once in a while, we have something that kind of makes the fog lift and we see the brokenness of the world, right? Every once in a while, somebody goes in and shoots up a school and we're like, man, it's terrible out there. The fog's lifted. I see it, right? Or someone we know, someone we love gets sick and something happens, or we get sick and the fog kind of lifts and we kind of see that things are not great, right? So there's something deep in all of us that's kind of like, there has to be more than this, right? There has to be more than what we see in this world today. And that there has to be more idea that we get, it's a gift from God for us. It's a gift from God that will lead us ultimately to what God would have us have in Him. Right? That's why the there has to be more is inside of us. The world that we live in now is, although it is the same world, is the same place, it's not the world that God initially created for us, right? the world we are living in is not the world as God created it. So in Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, we see this triune God of the universe, right? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, in perfect contentment as the Godhead, existing together, loving each other. And as we see in the beginning, in Genesis 1:1, right, God begins to create. And throughout the chapter, God creates this, God creates that, and he speaks it into existence, and it is, right? And it kind of culminates in verse 31 of chapter 1, and it says, "Then God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. So the evening and the morning were the sixth day." And in Genesis 1 and 2, there's kind of this rhythm that's established, that's created, and it goes something like this, right? God created this, God created this, God created this. And at each point at the end, when God creates it, what does it say? It says, "And it was good." It was good. When God created everything, it was good. And at the end of the chapter, as we see, he says, "It was very good" when he finished, right? So, like I said, ultimately, you've got God with his canvas of creation, and he's painting a world that is not the world that you and I are inhabiting, right? And in the middle of this creation, as we see it coming together, this creation it's at perfect peace, right? There's no strife, there's no turmoil, none of those things, right? God creates everything in harmony and in rhythm, and he takes the man and he puts him in the garden, as we begin to see in chapter 2, gives him one rule, right? One thing. It's a clear-cut, don't do this kind of rule. And here's the rules we see in chapter 2, verse 15 through 17. It says this, "Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, 'Of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in that day you eat of it, you shall surely die.'" So we lay it out. One rule, not complex, right? And if we had time to kind of continue to dig into the story in chapters 1 and 2, here's kind of what you'd have, right? You got the man and the woman. You know, my middle school guys here, hold on to it for a minute. They're naked, right? They're naked and they don't care about it. Everything is at peace. Everything is free. There's no shame. There's none of that stuff. They're just there, right? Perfect world. No death, no disease, no pain, no shame, no sorrow. God has told them, be fruitful and multiply. All is good. The whole world is yours. Just don't eat from this tree. Not asking much. Pretty sweet deal. So here's the question I got for you this morning as I began to look at this is why would God even put the tree in the garden? Why is the tree there, right? I think it's kind of the equivalent of, now my kids are older now, but let's go back to when they were kids. If I go ahead and get the pistol out of the closet or the drawer or whatever, and I load a round in the chamber, cock it, set it on the table, and tell my kids, "Hey, the house is yours. Do whatever you want. Just don't touch that gun. Whatever you do, you can do whatever you want. Just don't touch that gun." And then walk away, right? That would probably make me a pretty bad father, right? Wouldn't be up for Father of the Year if I did that, right? Just don't touch that pistol, right? So here's why I think that the tree is there, right? The tree is there to weave into us from day one that obedience to God, that obedience to God's commands brings joy into our life, brings fullness. That submission to God is a good thing. So think about what has happened up to this point, right? God creates a masterpiece of the world. He says, "You're my stewards. Here you go, all the trees, all the mountains, all the rivers are yours. Be my steward, don't do this," right? Obedience brings joy. And even today, thousands of years ago in the Garden of Eden to today, that's true for us. When we are obedient to the commands of God, it brings joy into our life. Unfortunately, Adam and Eve have the attention span and or the ability to obey about like a two-year-old does, because we don't get but a few verses later after this command that the entire thing just kind of absolutely unravels, right? We don't have time to read it all through it, but I'm going to encourage you to kind of dig around in Genesis 1 and 2 and see kind of what's going on there, because that's the good stuff, right? It's good up to that point, but we're going to get into Genesis 3. We're going to see kind of what happens here. So Genesis 3, starting in verse 1. "Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be open, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. So let's stop there for a moment. So Genesis chapter 3, you have Adam and Eve walking in the garden, right? Adam is there as dumb and passive as it seems like he can be. I wish that we had more to this. I wish God had really told us what was going on, but we don't get that here, right? We just know that they are there. They're walking in the garden. They go in there. The serpent interacts with Eve, begins to have a conversation with her, and starts lying to Eve right off the bat. And a lie to this day that we all tend to buy into, right? He says, "Did God say that you can't have the fruit from that tree?" And Eve kind of comes back and says, "Yeah." He says, "You know, we can't even touch it." You know, and we didn't see that in the first verse. God just says, "Don't eat from it." But she already begins to, it seems like, kind of add on to this. "Yeah, we can't even touch it or we'll die." And, you know, the snake comes back with, "Hey, that's not true. That's not true. I know God said that, but it's not true. He just knows that if you eat of this fruit, you're going to be a better God than he is. You're going to know what he knows, and you're going to be able to do things better than he does it." Once again, Adam, it seems like, is right there, right? What's this guy doing? And, you know, most of us dumb guys, I kind of imagine she's over here talking, and he's kind of like, "Hey, Eve, look at that one. I named that one dove. I named that one pigeon. Hey, check this out." You know, and he's just kind of over here doing his own thing, and he's just completely unaware, it seems like, of this conversation that is going on. He is being a complete moron, seems like, staring into the clouds, and Eve, it sees that this fruit is pleasing. It looks good. It looks like what she wants, right? So she takes it and she eats it, hands it to her husband. We don't see a question out of Adam. We don't see, "Hey, what's going on? What is this? Where'd it come from?" Just, thank you. That looks good. And he's right into the fruit, just like she is, takes a bite, right? And at that moment, as try to make it funny, try to make it light, but at that moment, outright rebellion from mankind is declared against the King of Glory, against the Creator of the universe, against the King of the world. And at that moment, the world fractures. It breaks. And all that peace, all that rhythm at every level of the universe is no longer there. In Genesis 3:8, it goes on to say, "And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden." Now, it doesn't seem like much there in that verse, but that's a heartbreaking verse if we really look into what's kind of going on right here at this moment as we get to verse 8 in chapter 3. Because before sin enters the world, there is no shame. There is nothing to hide. There is only outright joy in the presence of God. And now, one verse later, what has happened, right? There's shame. There's the understanding of their nakedness, right? They run, they hide. And it also seems like it made them dumb, or even dumber than Adam was before, because where'd they go hide? They hid in the trees. It's like the Creator of everything is coming. Where to? To the trees. You know, he's not going to see us there, right? Because, and here's a free one for you this morning. Sin makes you dumb. Sin makes you dumb. It does. You do dumb things when you let sin come into your life. So let's keep reading. Keep reading here. Verse 9. "But the Lord God called to the man, 'Where are you?' He answered, 'I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid.' And he said, 'Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?' The man said, 'The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it.' Then the Lord God said to the woman, 'What is this you have done?' The woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. To the woman he said, I will make your pains in childbearing very severe. With painful labor you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you. To Adam he said, because you listened to your wife and ate fruit from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat food from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. So what we're reading here in this grouping of texts, it's a complete kind of reordering of creation from how God designed it to be into what you and I currently live in, right? So here's what you see. Creation itself, reordered, fractured, snake onto your belly. There's now strife where there was peace, where there was rhythm. Now you have kind of a cosmos in chaos. I kind of think about it, it's kind of like Dancing with the Stars. I don't know how many of you are with Dancing with the Stars, right? But so you've got this professional dancer who can, you put music on and they just move to the rhythm and it's great. And you bring in some celebrity who has no idea of what dancing is, and you put them out there and they try to do this dance and it just doesn't look right. It doesn't seem right. The rhythm is not there. That's kind of the world now. It was this beautiful thing. I feel like I'm trying to dance for you. I can feel it coming, but I am that person with no rhythm, right? I could dance for you and show you what the world is like once sin comes in and fractures it, because that is what no rhythm would look like. But that's kind of the idea that kind of popped in my head when I saw that, as weird as it is, right? That all of a sudden there's just this, it's disjointed. It doesn't work right. So we have violence where there was no violence. We see this in the New Testament. If you've read through the book of Romans, which is a wonderful book to read through, it says that all of creation was subjected to futility, right? And we also read in Romans 8 that all of creation is kind of, it says it's experiencing the pains of childbirth. And we saw that God had just spoke about that with Eve. Now, I've never experienced the pain of childbirth, right? I have been in the room. It looks awful. Want no part of it. Right? Absolutely no part of it. You know, my wife said things I didn't know that were in her, right? Now she's like, you're up here lying in the pulpit. No, I don't remember exactly what she said. I know she wasn't happy at certain points. Once it's all over, happy as can be. But it's not, you know, and we can all relate, right? You know, that it can be some interesting things go on through the pains of childbirth, right? And the Bible says that all of creation has kind of been subjected to this futility. And that kind of means, it means kind of hard pressed. That is, it's not what it used to be. It used to be full, but now it's hard pressed, right? It's been pressed down into this idea of futility, that it's just not working like it was before. And then it's in pain, almost the idea of the pain of childbirth, which if you've experienced it, you know, is pretty brutal, right? And God says to them, he gets this point, and he speaks and he says, who told you that you were naked, right? And that woman just gave me some fruit. So we see right here already as it comes in, right? God says to Adam, who told you were naked? And the bus is coming down the road. And real quick, Adam slides Eve right underneath the bus. And he says, hey, it's the woman, right? I was just over here telling her about these birds that I had just named and trying to get her to look at all this stuff I had done. And she hands me the fruit and I ate it. It's the woman, right? And here's kind of what I want you to notice about the nature of our relationships in relation to sin, right? Notice in the story, nobody wants to own it, right? Nobody wants to take responsibility. It's the woman that you gave me. Woman says, hey, it was the serpent. It was the snake. It's his fault, right? It's like nobody is ever responsible for anything. And sin begins to create kind of a havoc in our relationships if no one is ever to blame, right? Relationships get blown up. He goes on, right? Pain is amplified, right? Did you see that? As we said before, your pain is going to increase in childbirth. And I don't even think that has to do just with childbirth. All pain is kind of turned up, right? And then how about this one? Work becomes work. Work becomes work, right? We have been designed by God to work and to work hard and to enjoy work. But what happens here in this text is that work kind of, it becomes toilsome. It becomes, it's not fun, right? It's not, it becomes wearying. It becomes exhausting. We were, all that we were meant to cultivate and enjoy now begins to kind of war against us. Now, you may not believe this because I know, you know, for many years, Mark told you I was a big pansy, which I kind of am. But when I was young, when my mom and my stepdad got married, he loved to play in a big garden. And once I became part of that family, I became a gardener myself, right, whether I wanted to be or not. So during those times, I would have to go out there and do those things. Gardening is not fun. Cultivating food, even though as enjoyable as it may seem once you're eating it, it's not fun when you're doing it, right? Digging potatoes, picking green beans, corn, cutting okra, all those things, they're not fun. They're hard. And if you don't do them exactly the right way at exactly the right time, what do your crops do? They revolt again. They die, right? You don't get what you were hoping to get out of them. And all that comes from this point in time when sin kind of came into the world, right? There was going to be a time that work didn't produce thorns and thistles, but that day is gone. And then we get to the big one here in verse 19. We get to the and this is where we're going to stop in Scripture today. Then I got a few points I want to share with you. This is the big one here. Verse 19, he says, "In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you shall return." So here we begin to see the reign of death that rules over mankind, that rules over us all, right? And this is what you kind of begin to feel when you feel like that something is not right, that something is not right in the world. Now we all kind of deal with that in different ways. Maybe with you it's anxiety, it's depression, or it's enslavement to some addiction or something like that. But what you're feeling in that moment, that there's kind of something at a kind of a soul level, even inside of us, where kind of I feel like kind of our souls kind of remember Genesis 1 and 2, that it was supposed to be this way, and yet now it's not that way. Now it's hard, and it's broken, and it's fractured, right? And according to Romans 8, once again, as it talks about creation kind of being in futility and things being hard, it says that our souls groan and kind of long for this time before everything was broken, right? That our souls long for creation to be put back to the way it was supposed to be. And we can feel that this isn't right, where we're at, right? And we have a need to kind of fix it. We have a need to kind of to fill this hole, right? There's a gnawing in our gut that says there's more to it than this. So what we do is this. We try to seek redemption for ourselves. We try to reconcile. We try to rescue ourselves apart from God. And there's four different places I feel like that we kind of run to fix ourselves, to redeem ourselves, to reconcile ourselves, that are never going to work. But yet we continue to run to those things. That something is wrong, kind of I have to fix it places. And the first of those, the most common for us, and I think is also the kind of the craziest one, is that we run to ourselves. That's the first place we go. We always run to ourselves first, right? And kind of here's what we do. We've thoroughly convinced ourselves that a better version of us is what's going to finally solve what it is that bothers us. We kind of have this future version of ourselves pictured out there in our minds where we kind of say, when we get to that point, that this frustration of there has to be something more is going to vanish. It's going to go away. But here's kind of what I want to lay before you. Here's what I want you to think about. 1 or 2 years ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, you thought you were going to be there today. So how's that going? Have you reached that point where that frustration is gone, right? Are you still a little bit disappointed with maybe who you are or where you're at? You've not reached that point, right? And see, this is the game. We kind of perpetually push it forward. Well, in 2 more years, I'll be there. 5 more years, I'll get there, right? And here's what's crazy about it, right? You would be hard-pressed to find anyone who has lied to you or disappointed you more than yourself. Yet we continue to go back to that person and let them tell us what a great God we are to ourselves, right? we simultaneously, we realize that we've been lied to and disappointed more by ourselves, but we, at the same time, applaud ourselves for our great sovereignty in our lives, for our great power and authority, how we are such great gods, right? It's like, I can't figure this thing out, but me trying to do it is better than some other authority that might try to tell me how to do it. And here's something I need you to kind of hear today. And don't take this the wrong way, because I know the world tries to tell us a little bit different than this, but here's kind of the thing. You will never be good enough for God. Does that make sense? You will never get to a point where you will do what you need to do to be good enough for God. It's not how it works, right? If we could do that, that future version of yourself that you have in your head, the one with the six-pack abs and the pockets full of cash, he is going to be just as disappointing to you as where you're at now, right, as you find yourself right now. We will never be good enough for God. We will not be able to satisfy what has gone wrong inside of us through that. The world is broken. We are broken, right? Which is why this is such bad news. Because if I could fix it, if I could just be good enough for God, there would be no need for the good news. There would be no need for what has to happen that we're going to talk about a little later, right? So a better version of ourself solves nothing, which leads me to the second point, right? So when we can't kind of quiet our soul in ourselves, when we can't fill that hole and figure out what's more, and we can't do it through ourselves, we go to other people to try to help us. So the second thing is others, right? And our culture kind of jumps on this one like a predator, right? It just kind of works this kind of idea all the time. And I can't believe how many of us think that other people are going to complete us, right? Now, I love Jerry Maguire, the movie, just as much as the next person. And you see that line from there where Tom Cruise looks and says, "You complete me," right? And he wins the girl and wins the day, and it's all good, right? But it's not true, right? It's not what it is, right? And the fracture, I think, in the foundation of every relationship, whether it's a marriage relationship, whether it's a friendship, or here's a good one for you, whether it's parent to child, it is kind of this fracture of, you will satisfy me or you will complete me. You are what I need to do that, right? And that idea, it's almost poison to us when we take that and put it in ourselves, right? Now, Kim's going to want me to preach every week after what I'm about to say here, but I love my wife. She is ridiculously awesome. She's like, "You don't ever say that to me in person," but here I am saying it for everybody else, right? But, and I'm not saying that to get points, but she's my best friend. She's a gift from God. All those other sappy things that we say, right? And outside of my salvation, she's honestly the best thing God has ever given me, right? So there you go. I love her, but she is not my God, right? She has not completed me. She has not satisfied my soul, right? She fills my heart. I love her. She's a great friend. She's a great helpmate. Is when all is said and done, is she who I needed to do what it is God would have me to do? Yes. But is she my God? No, she would make a terrible God. Terrible. Terrible God. I remember Mark used to tell her that, you know, she needed to fill her grace bucket up more, because once she pours the grace bucket out, she doesn't fill it back up. So we'd all be in trouble, right? If she was God. But if I expect her to satisfy my soul, to fix that hole where I say, what's going to fill that hole? If I expect her to do that, I am trying to make her my God. If you try to do that with your friends, you are trying to make them your God. If you do that with your children, you are making them your God. They will not fill that hole, right? If you put those expectations on them to fill that emptiness in you, you're just going to sow conflict into your life. They can't do it. It's impossible. You're putting too much on them. So almost every divorce, at the broken part of that foundation of that relationship, is that expectation that one person put on the other, that person never could be, that they had to be the one that was satisfying and complete, right? They should have found that. We should find that, not in our relationships, but in our Creator, right? The Creator of the universe, instead of expecting that from another broken person who is just as messed up as we are. It's not going to work. We have to find fullness of life in God, in Jesus Christ, not in others. So the expectations that others are going to fill that puts an impossible weight on them, whether those are friends, spouses, children, can't do it, right? We can't go to the well of other people. Third thing is the world. So the world is tricky because the world kind of feels good. And it kind of, here's what I mean by the world, kind of two parts here. One, there's the things, the stuff, the things the world can provide. And isn't it kind of interesting how new stuff makes us feel like better human beings? Right? I got a new shirt on today. I got new pants. I got a new tie. If you didn't know, back in June, our house caught on fire. All my stuff is gone. So for the past couple of months, I've been having to buy some new stuff, been having to buy new clothes. And when you buy new things, it kind of makes you feel better, right? You walk a little taller, chest sticks out a little more. You get a new ride, you know, you feel better, right? Right, Zach? You get that new Toyota riding around in it, and kind of chin goes up a little higher, doesn't it? Right? We feel good when we get those new things sometimes, right? You get that new iPhone, right? It's kind of crazy the effect that new things and new stuff has on, almost like a drug-like effect on us, right? So we're not better. We're not any different. We're just someone with more stuff or more debt or these types of things, right? It has an effect on us, and it's dangerous. Because what we got to understand, what we got to know, is that everything we have is kind of transient. It's here one day, it's gone the next. I learned that more than anybody a couple months ago, right? One day, got stuff. Next day, things are caught on fire. Once they've been caught on fire, they're not, you know, you don't have them anymore. They're gone, right? It's done. It's over. You got to get different things, right? None of those things make us a better person. So then there's another side to the world that we have to look at as well. There's a thing, you know, if you start to look into theology and things, there's a thing called common grace. Common grace is that God gives to everyone. So common grace is God's good gifts to all people. Let me throw some of them out there, right? Food. Food is good. Do only Christians enjoy food? No. Non-Christians enjoy food as well, right? So food is a common grace that is given to everyone. The beauty of nature. Christians and non-Christians alike can enjoy the mountains. They can enjoy the going out into the water, on the rivers, the lakes, whatever, right? Rain, sun, all those things are common graces. Happiness is a common grace, right? Someone, just because they aren't saved doesn't mean they can't enjoy some happiness, right? All of those things can be enjoyed by believers and non-believers. But kind of here's the thing about the world, right? We kind of take a lot of these common graces and outside of the good and ordered way that God has and the boundaries that God has placed on those things, we take them and kind of, we mess them up. We don't use them in the right way. We kind of bring our destruction about through these things that God intended for good, right? Anybody who has children know that boundaries are good, right? It's a good thing that you put that little plastic gate thing up at the top of the stairs so that your small child doesn't plummet to their death at the bottom of your stairs, right? It's a good thing that you put that boundary up, right? Are you a bad parent if you set that boundary up? No, right? You're an awesome parent when you do that. So it doesn't make you a bad parent to set and protect and set boundaries for your child. So in the same way, God says, use food like this. I've given you this common thing that everyone can use. Use it this way. Enjoy drink like this. Enjoy sex like this. All these things, these common graces, right? God is not trying to take anything from you. He's trying to let you enjoy these things. Because how would God be glorified if God's big plan was, you're going to follow me because I've got hell here in my back pocket that I can hang over you. But I'm going to make you miserable while you follow me. Because I don't want you to do anything that even looks or sounds fun. And if you try to do one of those fun things, I'm going to send you to hell. Right? That's not God's plan for us. That'd be a terrible plan. He'd be a terrible God, right? God's plan is actually the opposite of that. He's like, let me show you the fullness of joy. Let me show you what it's like when you use things inside the boundaries and the boundaries that I've set for them. Let me show you how good and full they can be. Matter of fact, Jesus says it this way in John 10:10. He says, I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. So when we run to the world, when we run to the world outside of the boundaries that God has created for things to be enjoyed in, we end up hurting ourselves. We end up hamstringing ourselves, right? Food is good. It's to be enjoyed. But we shouldn't run to food for comfort. We shouldn't run there for support, and we shouldn't make it our God. You think, make food a God? We do it sometimes. If that's where we go for our comfort, support, our love, our feeling of acceptance, our feeling of making ourselves worthy, right? Sex is good and right and beautiful, and it's enjoyable whether you're a believer or not a believer. But Jesus clearly teaches that sexual sin does damage to the soul in a way that other sins don't, right? And when we use it outside the boundaries of what God created it to be and to be enjoyed in, we hurt ourselves in that, right? We hurt our relationships. We hurt our future relationships. So just a couple ways to see that when we use these common graces, these common goods in the wrong way, we can hurt ourselves, right? So the world can't satisfy us in those ways with the trinkets, with the toys. And don't you already know, don't you get it, that you're kind of stuck in this cycle that knowing that the more stuff you get, it doesn't end up making you happy. You just got to have more stuff. Because if the truth was that more stuff would make us happy, then all the rich and the elite out there that have all the money to have whatever they want would just be super happy, right? Does it seem like some of those people are real happy? Do those people still commit suicide because they had despair, they just couldn't go on in this world? Well, they had everything, right? So that just shows us, yet we see that, we see it in examples of others, we know it and experience it in our own lives, yet we continue to kind of buy in that lie that we actually need more of what we already have. Do you see kind of the foolishness there? So, last thing, you're not going to find it in you, you're not going to find it in others, you're not going to find it in the world. Leaves us one more. You're not going to find it in religion either, right? Religion isn't going to fix this, right? And what I mean by religion is kind of all these monotheistic one God religions who try to teach this kind of type of trying to please a God, right? So it's the I'm going to the things that I feel I need to do. I want to tilt the scales in my direction. I'm going to follow this list of things here that I feel like I need to do to please God, and it's going to tilt the scales in my favor. That's what's going to satisfy me. I'm going to give myself over to these list of things, whether that's for Yahweh, whether that's for Allah, whether that's for Buddha, whatever God it is. It happens in all these different types of religions, right? Let me obey these commandments. And if I'm good enough at obeying these commandments, then I'm going to be good. I'll make it in. I'll get into heaven. And that's all I got to do. Just want to get in the gates. So now when we live that way, we don't really understand or know how to measure it. So what we do is we look around at each other and we think, oh, well, I'm running with these other crazy people and all I got to do is be better than them, right? We all know David Ray cusses like a sailor. I just got to cuss less than David Ray, right? We all know Daniel Pinkston can't put the drink down, so as long as I drink less than Daniel Pinkston, then I'm good, right? So we compare and we say, if I'm just better than that person, if I just follow the list of rules better than that person, then it's all going to be good. I'll fill that hole inside myself. But really, when we get stuck in religion and just following a list of rules, we become more trapped, more enslaved than really just about any of the other things, right? Isaiah says it like this in Isaiah 55:2. He says, why do you spend money for what is not bread and your wages for what does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good and let your soul delight itself in abundance. Do you see the invitation of God there? It's a great invitation, right? He says, why do you keep eating bread? Why do you keep doing things? Why do you keep trying to follow a list? Why do you keep trying to find someone else to complete you? Those things aren't going to satisfy you. Why do you keep going to those wells? Do you want real food? Do you want rich food? Get in here. Come to me. Come see me, and I will fill you up. I will satisfy you. I will be the thing. I will be the one that you need, right? So what are we looking for, right? We're looking for redemption. We're looking for rescue. We're looking for reconciliation. It's not going to be found in us. It's not going to be found in others. It's not going to be found in the world. It's not even going to be found by just coming in here and sitting down and coming to church and doing the things that you think you're supposed to do, right? So am I just kind of saying that we're all lost causes? Yeah, pretty much, We are. We're all lost causes. That's kind of what I'm saying today. It's kind of where we're landing today, right? There's nothing in us that can bring rescue to us, that can bring redemption to us, that can bring reconciliation, that's going to fill that hole of eternity that is inside each and every one of us, right? But the good news is, like I said, there's something that can, right? The answer to the test has already been given. We sang about the name of Jesus this morning, and that's the direction we're going to go next week. And as we get ready to finish, we're going to, Mitch, if you won't come on and make your way up here. I don't want to leave you in a place where it's just bad news, you know. I think somebody would be mad at me if I didn't say that, go ahead and let you know there's good news. If you're in that spot this morning, if you're here and you're like, you know, all those things you said, that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to fill that hole with so many other things, and I don't really know what's going to fill it. I don't know what's going to be the thing that's going to make me right. Well, we've got the answer for you. It is Jesus, and we're going to talk more and more about what it is that he's done for you. God loves us so much that he wasn't going to leave us in this place where we would be empty, right? He gave us a way out. Not that we have to be good enough, but that he paid that price for us. So if you want to know more about that today, I want you to come up here. Talk to me, talk to Pastor Gary, talk to someone. We will tell you what the good news is about. We will let you know how it is you can fill that hole inside of you. If you're here today and you do know Jesus, right? You have experienced the saving grace of God. Yet still, even when we experience that, we kind of find ourselves going back to these wells from time to time. We start looking at ourselves again, trying to get ourselves, we kind of get away from God a little bit. We say, oh, well, I'll fix myself up and then I'll go back. Or we start looking to our other relationships. Or we start looking to the world. Or we start trying to follow a list of rules. If we can all kind of get caught up in those traps again from time to time. If you've been there, if you're in it, if you realize that, come and repent. That's what we got to do. That's what God calls us to do. When we realize, as Christians, we realize that we've not been doing the right thing, he calls us to come, repent, ask him to forgive us, and then let's get back into the right place. Let's get back into the right place of having God be the one who fills us up. Let's stop putting that pressure on our kids. Let's stop putting that pressure on our spouses. Let's stop putting that pressure on other people. Let's stop trying to fix ourselves to do it. And let's start letting God do what it is he has wanted to do from the beginning, is be our God, to love us, put us into that right place and that right relationship with him, and make things the way that they were supposed to be again. Because one day, things are going to be right again. Things are going to be right again. We're going to get back to Genesis 1 and 2. We're going to get back to being in right relationship with God, where things are at peace. And everything has been made right. But we only do that through Jesus, by accepting him, by letting him be our Lord and Savior. It is the only way. So if you want to do that today, please do not hesitate. Please come. If you'll stand with me, I'm going to pray, and then we will sing. Father, I love you. God, I thank you for this time. I thank you for this day. God, I just, I thank you for Jesus, for that name that we sang of today. And as we'll get into more next week, God, and we talk about what it is that you have done, Jesus coming and paying the price, God, for us being what we can't be, being good enough where we can't be good enough. And Father, if there is anyone in here, God, who does not know you, God, who has not trusted you as their Lord and Savior, Father, I pray that they would come today, God, that they would stop trying to look for it in themselves and in others and the world and in religion, God, and begin to look for it in you, because that's the only place that it's found. Father, I pray that you would pierce their heart, God, that you would convict in this place today, that you would convict hearts, God, and that we would come seeking redemption in you. And for those of us that need to come and repent, Father, I pray that we would. Pray, God, that we would put ourselves back in right relationship with you, God, so that we can have fullness of life, God, that so we can be people who go into our workplaces, into our homes, and into our lives every day, God, where people would see that the gospel, that the good news is real and alive in our lives today. Father, I pray that you would be with us as we continue to move forward, God, and the meetings that are going on today. And I just pray that you would be all in that, God, and you would be speaking and working through all of those things. And we love you and we trust you. In Jesus' name I pray. with us today. We appreciate it. You're supposed to be here back here at 4:30 for church council. Deacons, please do. And with that, any other announcements thought of since then? Deb, she's leaving. She don't have an announcement. 6 o'clock, women's Bible study. 6:30, please come do this. The more of us, it just takes a few moments when everyone comes and does this together. It makes it so much easier. So much easier. All right? Andy, if you'll lead us to prayer.
Father, I thank you for the message that you've shared with us through Charles. And I pray that your words pierce our heart as we go. We go into this broken world, but you've given us the light to go into the world and proclaim the good news and to heal those that we come across. And we can only do that through your power. So go with, be with us and guide us as we go. In your name I pray. Amen.